And now, please welcome Philip Kerr.
Thank you for coming.
I'll do the
Jerry Bruckheimer thing. Step away from the lectern, which makes it a bit more friendly. Well, thank you for coming. It was nice of them to mention the RBA Book Award. Now, I remember when I learned about this, I was in Cuba, and I was researching a Bernie Gunther novel, and I was in a hotel and having breakfast, and I got a phone call, and this person from Barcelona rang up and said, "Oh, you won the RBA Novella Negra Book Award." And I said, "Oh, great, how much?" Thinking, you know, a couple of hundred euros or something like that. And she said, 130,000 euros.
Wow.
Yeah, that's what I said. I said, sorry, come on. Because most surprises, you know, have nothing. So that made my Cuban trip, actually. You know, I sort of suddenly thought, oh, I can afford to be here after all. There are very few prizes that come with any money. I just got one in Greece. This sounds really arrogant to say it, but I mean, I'm sorry about this. I won one in Greece last weekend, which I couldn't go to because I was in Houston, for a children's novel I wrote called The Winter Horses, which is a Holocaust novel for children. Well, it sounds unlikely, I know, but I was always irritated with other Holocaust novels for children. Well, I think you probably all know the one I mean, actually, you know, The Boy in the Striped Pyjamas. And I kept reading the synopsis of this thing, I kept thinking, your life expectancy as a child at Auschwitz was 6 hours. Wow. So quite how you would sort of manage to sort of cement a friendship with the son of a German commander, I really don't know. 6 hours, horrifying. Whenever I come to a bookshop, I have to sort of mentally look at it and try and remember what I said the last time, so I don't contradict myself. Did I give speech A, speech B, speech C, or a combination of the three? But I know I've been here several times before, so I'm going to assume that everything I've said before, I can't say again. So I've got to come up with a whole lot of new stuff, actually, which puts me on my mettle. So I can leave out all the crap autobiographical stuff about how I became a writer and where I get my ideas from and all this kind of stuff. This is my 35th published book. Not 35th book I've written, because I wrote many more than that before I actually got published. A French television crew came to my house last summer. And I was feeling a little bit low for various reasons, which I won't go into. And they sort of did the mandatory, you know, filming the author at his desk and behind the computer. And then they did a sort of tracking shot of all the books I'd written on my shelf. And then they said, Mr. Kerr, you have written a lot of books. And you must be very proud. Actually, this is pretty good French impersonation. And I said, I think about proud, though. I sort of look at it and I sort of feel, well, it's beginning to look like an obsessional compulsive disorder, actually. Because I sort of look at it now and I sort of think of what I could have been doing when I was writing all those books. I could have been actually living, having a proper life, and not making up stories, which seems like a kind of slightly bizarre, weird thing to do, which is to sort of secrete yourself away in a room all day and just make up stories, which is what I did when I was a kid. I mean, you know, I'm doing exactly the same thing I did when I was 10 years old. The only difference is I got sort of more computers, and I mean, then I was doing it with a notebook and a pencil. But, you know, I'm not much moved on from that right now. Which is kind of how it should be, really, you know, because you sort of, it's nice to have a connection with, you know, the young you, and the young writer, because this is really always what I wanted to do. So there we are, the French. I do love the French, actually. I did a television program with Gérard Depardieu Have I told you about this? Oh, it's fantastic. Gerard rang me up, and he said, I thought, at first, for a minute, I thought it wasn't Gerard, but then he has a very distinctive sort of sound, you know. And he said, but Philip, I am doing a program about food. There is each, I'm doing regions of France, but I also want to do, I want to do Scotland. And you are the only famous Scots person I have ever heard of. So, how could I say no? I said, well, who are the other people you're doing the program with, Gerard? He said, well, I have Catherine Deneuve, I have Fanny Ardon, I have Roberto Benigni, and I thought, I'm in. I'm in. If I'm in the same sort of paragraph as those guys, then I'll come. So, I was in France, but I had to fly up to Scotland to do the program. So I met Gerard in Inverness, of all places. Now, here was the concept of the program, which was uniquely Gerard and uniquely French. The idea was that we would lean across the farm gate, looking at a young heifer. Gerard would pick the heifer out. We would then slaughter it, butcher it, cook it, and eat it. And you think, only in France would you dare to even think of that. But even the French producer was sort of balking at the idea of slaughtering a heifer, and he said, I'm not sure, Gerard, I don't think this, you know, what is wrong with you? What is wrong with people? You know, they eat meat. And he related a previous program he'd done when he said, I have these beautiful two little piglets, and I am nursing them in my arms. I am stroking them very gently, very gently. And then I cut their throats. And I butchered them. And I said, well, is all this on camera? And he said, yes, yes, yeah. I said, well, what are the ratings? Anyway, we didn't do that. We didn't do that. We decided that we were going to catch a fish, a salmon, instead. But the trouble was, it was Sunday. And in Scotland, you're not allowed to catch a salmon on a Sunday. So, yeah, the Scots and religion, you see. And so they sent the producer around virtually the whole of Scotland, the supermarkets, looking for a large enough salmon that we could chuck in the river with our hook, so that Gerard could sort of pull it out, you know. I've got to say, he was one of the nicest, funniest, great guys to be around, actually, you know. My French is pretty crap, and when we recorded the program, we were just sitting in front of this sort of Scottish chateau talking about food, and I thought, well, Gerard asked me a question, I answer, and I have to keep going, because I could see Gerard is eating, you know, so they'll cut back to him, his mouth is full of food. But actually, you know, what happened was I had answered, finally ran out of French, and Gerard just turned to one side and go, no, don't worry, Philip, they will cut it out later. So I'll conclude my Gerard stories with this one, which I've got to tell you. I said to Gerard, look, I've always wanted to know this, Gerard. I heard a story. When you were making Columbus, 1492, the conquest of paradise, I heard that you had a case of your own red wine on the boat that was the Santa Maria every day, and you would drink it. And at the end of the day, you would swim to shore, but the studio was kind of worried that you were going to drown, so they sent a boat alongside you, you know. And he looked at me for a minute and said, well, Philippe, this is not true. It was a case of white wine, as if this made a big difference. And let me tell you why I drink a whole case of white wine. Because I am afraid of the sharks, okay? And I think maybe if I drink a whole case of white wine, I won't be afraid of sharks. And I said, well, did it work? He said, yes. I swim, I see a shark, and I don't give a shit. And well, the way he presented the story, it just sounded so wonderfully sort of logical, you know. How could you fault that logic? He did actually also add this other story, which I thought was equally hilarious. He was chucked off an EasyJet flight because he urinated on the floor. And he was said to the stewardess, she said, I have to go to the bathroom. And she said, no, we're taking off, so you can't go. And he said, well, look, I'm a big man, I have to go, you know. And so he says to his friend, who's drinking a bottle of Perrier, drink the water, give me the bottle. So his friend drinks the bottle, and Gerald starts to use it. And he says, but you know, Philip, it is a very small bottle. And the woman behind me, she's getting very upset because, you know, it is going on the floor. It's going on her coat and everything. You know? So these are some of the hilarious things that as an author I end up doing. Quite recently, the BBC rang me up and said, would I do a lecture for the radio about a human organ? And I could pick the human organ I was going to talk about. Yeah. So naturally, I sort of said, well, I'll pick the penis, okay? Because the penis is the only human organ you can get some laughs. You can't think of any other human. And also, I said, it's the only human organ I have any kind of familiarity with, to be honest. So I spoke to my wife about it. She said, no, you can't do the penis. Come on, you know. And I said, well, okay, shall I do the vagina? Because that's the only other organ that I sort of feel, you know, I sort of familiarity with. No, she said, you can't do that one either. So I did the brain, which was a natural progression from... And I said, look, I'll do the brain on one condition, which is I get to see a brain, a living brain, a brain operation. So the BBC sorted me out a brain operation to go and see. So I turn up at the main hospital in London, which does brain operations. I put all my scrubs on and I'm looking, you know, exactly like George Clooney in ER. And actually people are asking me stuff, which was kind of worrying, you know, because I had an x-ray in my hand and some nurse comes up to me and asks me what's happening. And I looked at the, and I remember the other thing was, the guy, he's already anaesthetized, he's naked on the trolley. And he's got a brain tattooed on his chest. And I thought, what is that about? Is he worried the surgeon's not going to get it right? Hey, folks, it's not the heart today, it's the head, okay. So I tug off I've got the x-ray in my hand, and it says on the top of the x-ray, temporal anterior lobotomy. And I'm slightly horrified because, like most people, my knowledge of lobotomy extends to Jack Nicholson in One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest. Wonderful book, a marvellous film, and you all remember what happens at the end. If you haven't, I'm not going to spoil it for you. Maybe I have. And of course, I remember the even more tragic case of Rosemary Kennedy, who was the daughter of Joe Kennedy. I've got to be careful now because I'm in Boston. I have to remember whatever I say about Joe Kennedy is going to be muted here. So I'll leave all the stuff about Joe Kennedy being an evil man out. Okay. But anyway, poor Rosemary. She wasn't thick or anything. I mean, she was just a kind of willful girl. And she was very voluptuous, and apparently Joe was worried that she would like sort of get pregnant or something. So. She had virtually one of the first lobotomies going. And if you read the account of the operation, it's horrifying. The surgeons were operating, and they asked her to recite the Lord's Prayer while she was doing it, and they sort of went up the nostril with an ice pick. The plan was that when she stopped, when she got to, you know, forever and ever, maybe it would have worked. But in actual fact, she was reduced to the level of a 2-year-old. And she disappeared for 20 years, and none of the siblings knew. How did they not know? Your sister disappears for 20 years. You think, hang on. I know there are a lot of us, but I mean, there used to be one more at the end of the table, surely. Anyway, my thinking was, when I saw this words temporal anterior lobotomy, I just thought, my God, you know, how can we be doing this stuff again? So I had a little chat with the surgeon about it. He said, well, yeah, it's like now, it's a perfectly respectable operation again, because if you're a long-term epileptic and all drug treatment has failed, then what we do is we tackle it with surgery. And he showed me on the x-ray this tiny little lesion on the brain. And he said, what we do now is we attach electrodes to the head, and when the person has an epileptic fit, we can see what part of the brain is actually malfunctioning, because that's where all the electrical activity is centered. So I watched. It took 8.5 hours, and they were operating with some better stuff than an ice pick, I can tell you. And I realized this was, I had already got the subject of my lecture, which was the sort of restoration of the respectability of the lobotomy. And I called it breaking brain, because if you remember Vince Gilligan talking about Breaking Bad, he says, we take Mr. Chips and we turn him into Scarface. So I thought, well, we'll take an operation which is the equivalent of Scarface, and we'll turn it into Mr. Chips, and that's what I did. So, I only mentioned that to horrify you and get a few cheap laughs. To illustrate that I have one of the best jobs in the world, I think, which is I get to do all sorts of stuff. Before I move on to Bernie Gunther, I'll tell you about the books I wrote about soccer. I did 3 books about soccer. And I mean, they did all right in Britain, and they've done very well in Germany, and they did spectacularly well in Spain. And they're crime stories. It's about a manager who works for a top London club who has to solve a murder of the previous manager, and it's all to do with the world of crime and football and corruption. I mean, as if anything like that could actually happen. That's why it's fiction, you know. I mean, you can't imagine anybody from a football association sort of ever being included in a sort of international inquiry into corruption and bribery. Or so it seemed. So the Spanish asked me to turn up and promote the book. So I turn up in Barcelona, and I did all my interviews at the I mean, this is lost on you guys because soccer's not your thing, but Barcelona is like the sort of holy grail of football. And so I did all my interviews in the Nou Camp, in the dugout, which is where the manager sits. And I thought, this is marvellous, you know. And that night I was on the main TV show about football, talking about the book. And I thought, well, that's it, you know, I've done my bit. So I went back. A couple of days later, I got another phone call. Would I come back and do the same thing in Madrid? Because whatever I'd said in Barcelona didn't count. But if I'd said the same thing in Madrid, it would matter more. So I flew to Madrid, come out of the airport, and there is a kind of stretch limo, and I get in the stretch limo, and I go off to Real Madrid City, which is the training ground, which is the holy of holies. In fact, you can tell it's the holy of holies because there are fans on the outskirts of the training facility. Who are being sort of kept back by security guards. And this is just the training facility. When you go in, it's like James Bond. It's like the most spectacularly modern, luxurious hotel you've ever seen in your life. And outside the front is one of the senior Real Madrid directors, who gives me a tour, and takes me to the dressing room, and I stand out, and one by one, the players come out, shake my hand, and I thought, this is my life. You know, it's fantastic. And then that night, I did the main Madrid equivalent of what the British would call Match of the Day. So, and yet knowing nothing at all about football, which is the, you know, which is the constituent, qualification really for being on the program, it seems to me. Anyway, this book. This is number 11 of Bernie Gunther. Each one I write now, I think, can I do another one? Can I find something that I can work with that will give me another story? And it's getting harder and harder, I've got to say. And maybe that means, I don't know, maybe the book's get better as a result of that. I don't know. It's up to you to say. But this I had two or three ideas that got me started with this one. One was Bernie, at the end of the previous book, had been a concierge at a posh hotel. And I thought it's a perfect job for him because he's an ex-policeman. And a concierge is really just a policeman in a tailcoat because you've got to answer stupid questions, you know, like, you know, which way is the street, or what's the best restaurant, or where can I get a taxi, and stuff like that. And you're like a kind of traffic cop. And then you've got to throw the odd drunk out of the bar and stuff like that. And theoretically, you've got to sort of move prostitutes out of people's rooms and that sort of thing. Or rather, if it's the south of France, you've actually got to do it the other way. You know, shepherd them into the rooms because, you know, so many Russians and that sort of thing down there. There's no Russians here, right? I'm insulting them as well as Joe Kennedy. And the other great thing was the research meant I would have to obviously stay in the Grand Hotel Cap Ferrar, which is a beautiful hotel, but just up the road. And this is really the reason why I picked this place was the home, former home of Somerset Maugham, which was the Villa Moresque. And in his day, which is when the book is set, in the 1950s, Maugham was the most famous writer in the world and probably one of the richest. He was kind of the Stephen King of his day, but better. And he was a gay man with lots of gay friends and a gay nephew. And actually, the gay nephew became a novelist in his own right. He was called Robin Maugham. And he wrote a couple of quite good books, one of which became quite a famous film, scripted by Harold Pinter, which is called The Servant with Dirk Bogarde. And I thoroughly recommend it. One of my favourite films. It's kind of decadent, actually. Black and white. And Maugham is... although, you see, the law in England about being gay was much more draconian. If you were a gay man, had gay sex, you risked being chucked in prison. In France, it was slightly different. I mean, it was probably illegal as well, but the French, you know, are clever about not enforcing certain laws. I mean, staggering. I just saw on television tonight, France decided to outlaw prostitution, which is unbelievable, you know. I mean, like sort of 500 years of French history just sort of thrown out of the window. Unbelievable, you know. So, anyway, Maugham lived quite openly gay in the Villa Moresque, but even so, he was still subject to the occasional blackmail because, you know, ex-rent boys and stuff would turn up with photographs. He was probably more worried about his reputation in America and England, where his markets were. So he would quite often pay. He'd done a lot of film deals. So he was kind of worried that, you know, the film deals would evaporate if, you know, his life as a gay writer was exposed. Well, I discovered that one of the guests at the Villa Moresque in 1937 had been two guests. One was Guy Burgess and the other was Anthony Blunt. And I thought, that's my story. I thought, it's one thing to be blackmailed because of your relationship with Guy Burgess because he's gay. But if it then turns out he's the most famous spy in British history, then that's kind of double jeopardy. And that's essentially the basis of the plot. The other thing, of course, was why this would be extra sensitive to Somerset Maugham was for Somerset Maugham being a spy himself. And after the First World War, he went to Russia and ran a network of spies, quite a large network, 500 or 600 people for about 18 months. And after that, his connections with MI6 and MI5 were always pretty solid. And indeed, in the Second World War, when he had to take off from France and go to America, he was living in New York, and it's certainly a strong possibility that he was involved in liaising with British intelligence and the forerunner of the CIA, which was OSS, and while Bill Donovan, and essentially trying to help persuade the Americans to join the war. So that was the first part of the story that came to me, if you like. The second part was I'd always wanted to write a story about a maritime disaster in a place called Königsberg. Königsberg was the pearl of East Prussia. It was the most beautiful city. Prussia is the sort of bit which is sort of very, very far east of Berlin. And it was like a mini Berlin. Beautiful architecture, home of Kant. Kant spent his entire academic life at the University of Königsberg lecturing. It was, you know, it was a real beautiful place. But by 1944, 1945, it was surrounded with the Red Army. And Hitler had refused to let it surrender. So disaster was looming. And by now, the reputation of the Red Army went before it, and most of the German women in Königsberg were rightly afraid of what was going to happen. Because however bad the Battle for Berlin was, the Königsberg was worse. It was, I would say, it's probably the German equivalent of Stalingrad. Finally, the man who was in charge, the German officer in charge, agreed that women and children and non-combatants should be got out of the city. And various boats were arranged to take them out. And one was this boat called the Gustloff, the Wilhelm Gustloff, which set sail in, I think, January 1945 with 12,000 people on board. Now, people think the Titanic was the worst maritime disaster ever. The Gustloff puts it, you know, well down the league. 12,000 people on board, 9,500 died on this. It was sunk by a Russian submarine. In that one month alone, there were five or six other ships that went down, each of which had 5,000 or 6,000 people on board. So any one of which would have outranked the Titanic. And of course, you imagine these were Titanic conditions, because in the Baltic Sea it was freezing cold. You know, it was dark. The ships were massively overcrowded, so there were no chance of survival. So that was something I thought would be interesting to write about. So I thought I better go to Königsberg, except it's not Königsberg anymore. It's now called Kaliningrad. Now, when the Russians finally took over the city, they cleansed the city ethnically. All of the Germans who were not killed or taken off to labor camps because they were in the army were just literally sort of expelled from the city and sort of forced to fend for themselves in the countryside in winter, which meant, of course, they died. And the place was then filled with Russians, and it's now called Kaliningrad. And it's what the Russians call an oblast. It's a kind of enclave, which means it's the only part of the Russian Federation which is within the European Union. It's like how Berlin used to be in East Germany. It's just surrounded with a foreign country. Borders Lithuania. Anyway, it's for reasons military, it's kind of hard to get in and out of. There's a kind of Russian deep water port not very far away, and Putin is quite sensitive about Kaliningrad. So I thought, well, I've got to go. So I set about trying to go in, and it's bloody hard to get in, because you have to ring up this one or two travel agencies in Kaliningrad, who then arrange to meet you at the airport in Kaliningrad to give you your visa, which is a bizarre thing, because to fly into a country without a visa, to collect your visa before you can actually, it seems to defeat the purpose. But anyway, so my wife and I arrived in Kaliningrad, and on the wrong side of customs immigration, as it were, there was a lady who sold us our visas. Taped them into the passport, and then disappeared. And then we had to go through customs and immigration and hope that the visas worked. Well, my wife went through in 2 minutes, and I stood there for an hour. And for the hour I was standing there, you know, wondering why I wasn't actually getting into the country, I was thinking of all the reasons that I might not be getting in. One was, it was lunch, maybe. You know, in Russia everything stops, you know, it doesn't matter if there's someone there who's, that's just too bad, it's lunch, you know. So that was my first thought. The second was, well, in my football books that I talked about earlier, there was a whole chapter in one about how Putin had bribed FIFA to give Russia the World Cup in 2018 and stuff like that. And I thought, could it just be, maybe, that the Russian intelligence services are sort of going to give me a hard time for this? But anyway, finally I got in into the country. And boy, is it a dump. Don't ever go to Kaliningrad. I mean, it's like, it makes East Germany in the 70s and 80s look like Las Vegas. Really, it's that bad. And it's sad because, you know, I had all these books which were full of photographs of what Königsberg was like. And now all these hideous sort of East German sort of, well, East German style sort of concrete blocks. The people look miserable, downtrodden, there's nothing in the shops to buy, particularly. It's what you call an interesting holiday, you know, when you go. So we were quite glad to leave, finally, when, you know. But we were in the best hotel, the Radisson. It was, which was pretty crap, actually, but we knew it was the best hotel because Mr. Medvedev was in the next suite to us. So he's the Russian Prime Minister. So we thought, well, it must be good because he wouldn't come here if it's... And we knew it was his room because there were two Russian lady soldiers standing outside his suite, and very attractive too. But they had enormously fierce dogs and machine guns. So you thought, well, you know, no one's going to go up to them and say, hi, you know, what's the hotel like? Are you enjoying it? So don't ever go to Kaliningrad. That was the research I did for this particular book. I don't know that. I wouldn't say that I feel any more comfortable writing Bernie Gunther now than I used to, because, like I say, you know, with a series, you've done 11, and I'm currently doing 12. With a series, you always think maybe you should be addressing the possibility that you've written too much. I think if, you know, you look at other people who write series and they carry on a long time and you think, oh God, isn't it time you stopped? Well, I ask myself this question all the time. And I think it's a good question to ask, because if, you know, if you don't, there's a danger that you're just repeating yourself, and I can't bear the idea of doing that. So that's one reason why I sort of flit around in periods. You see, when I first started out, there was virtually no printed information about sort of German social history at all. Well, since then, there's been a kind of explosion of publishing in to do with this period. And you know, every few months there's a new book that gets published, and it sort of gives you, I mean, stuff I would love to have had 30 years ago, but I didn't. And places I would have loved to have gone that I couldn't, you know. So that's what's changed as well. So each time I think of a new book, I have to sort of find some history that will lead me by the hand. I recently did I've been starting some research for the next one. And this is in complete contrast to Kaliningrad, because a lot of this book will be set in a place called Obersalzberg, which some of you will know was where the Berghof, Hitler's country house, was. And it's one of the more fascinating places I've been to in Germany, and I thoroughly recommend it as a sort of tourist destination. There, not least because there's a very good hotel called the Kempinski. The Kempinski group is, you know, there are lots of luxury hotels. The Kempinski Hotel in Obersalzberg is built on the site of Goering's house, which means it's not that popular with a lot of Germans, actually. So you probably get a good rate Actually, I think it's sort of failing, to be honest. But it is one of the best group hotels in the group. So I came out of the hotel to do my first day's tourism. I sort of walked down the hill. And you walk down the hill having just enjoyed what must have been Goering's his view. And you walk past Bormann's, the wreckage of Bormann's house, and it is wreckage, it's just kind of like the foundations of the building that was there. And then there's a little hotel which is still there called the Turken Inn, which is a hotel again. I don't recommend you stay in that one actually, because underneath is a network of tunnels and bunkers. And it's even a jail, actually, you know, where prisoners were sort of kept. It was where the SS sort of, that were looking after Hitler over Salzburg, they were stationed. Well, you walk on a little bit further down the hill and you come to the foundations of Hitler's house. There's nothing to mark it out, but, you know, I mean, anybody who's going there for, you know, this historical reasons will know exactly where it was. But the sort of the really remarkable thing is you drive all the way up this meandering road to a place called the Kelstein, which is the sort of spur of rock on the highest mountain in the area. And there's a set of enormous bronze doors, which look like something out of Lord of the Rings. And when the doors open, you half expect to see the Lord Sauron standing there with bad dentistry. But in fact, there's a sort of long marble corridor, which is about, well, it's bigger than, higher than this room, and about as wide as this corridor. And it's big enough for it to take a large Mercedes, because Hitler was very lazy. He didn't like to walk. Despite all the photographs you see of Hitler walking around with his dog, and he was just a lazy sod. He would get in the car and drive everywhere. And about 100 meters at the end of this corridor is a set of beautifully polished brass doors, which looks like something from the Savoy Hotel. And then you sail 150, 200 meters up inside the mountain. And when you come out, you're in what was called the tea house, the Eagle's Nest. And guess what? It's still a tea house. Although when you come out of the elevator, you do half expect to see Blofeld with a white cat, because it is that kind of place. I mean, you know, you think, if you're going to be a dictator, this is kind of the best place to be it, really. So that is probably one of the more interesting places I had to go as in research for these books. I will ask you if you wish to ask me any questions, because I can just keep rambling on with this stuff all night. So if you have a question, then just chip in, you know. Yes, sir.
Actually, I have two questions for you. Completely disparate questions. One is, since you've been a visitor to Kaliningrad and given a lot of thought to Königsberg, whether you have any thoughts about the fate of the Amber Chamber. Mm. That's one question.
The Amber Room, yes. Well, the Amber Room was... Germany was the largest source of amber. And I think it was Frederick the Great gifted Peter the Great with what was called the Amber Room in the Hermitage Palace in St. Petersburg. And then when Leningrad was being besieged, the Russians tried to get it out because they regarded it as a sort of national treasure, and somehow it fell into the hands of the Germans, who then took it back to Königsberg. And then after that, it's a little bit of a mystery what happened to it. You probably remember quite recently there was a story in the news about some train of loot that had been discovered in a tunnel in Poland, and for a while it was assumed that the Amber Room might be on this train. It's all gone very quiet, actually, of late, and I suspect, well, people have said, well, maybe the train was booby-trapped and all this kind of stuff. No, I don't think it was. I mean, I think, actually, they sold us a dummy, and they went on the train. There's probably not much there. But probably tomorrow they'll probably find it all there. So. But equally, some people think that the Amber Room was actually on the Wilhelm Gustloff, and then it went to the bottom of the Baltic Sea or one of these other ships. certainly it's all disappeared. There's a man who's also mentioned in the book who's called Eric Koch, who was the galley to the governor of East Prussia. And he had stolen everything that was to be worth stealing and kept it at his sort of country house outside Königsberg. And he was recaptured after the war. He was no less culpable than any of the other people. The Poles kept him alive instead of hanging him like they hanged everyone else who was a Nazi war criminal. They kept him alive in the hope that he might actually reveal the true fate of the Amber Room. But he never did, and he died not so very long ago. So we don't really know, and I suspect we may never know, really.
Is a question about Eric Ambler. I just wondered whether or not, particularly given the fact that one of his many spy novels, and he's often said to be the sort of the dean of this whole school of writing, if there is such a thing, and certainly as a fellow Brit, and set, in fact, one of his books on the Riviera.
Yeah.
It's actually not one of his better ones, yeah. I don't think. But any comments on Ambler and his influence?
Well, getting to the Riviera, you see, that's always seems to be a very important thing to do if you're a writer. Actually, I can't say that's part of the job that I have any problem with at all. People often say to me, why did you write about Berlin at all? And in the beginning, I'm not from Germany. At the time, I'd done a postgraduate degree in German law and philosophy, and I was quite interested in the whole, the cultural and philosophical background to how Nazism came about. And when I decided I wanted to be a full-time novelist, I wanted to pick something I really wanted to write about, and I decided I would pick Berlin. And at this point, I'm fond of giving you a kind of Donald Trumpism. It could have been said by Donald Trump, I think, anyway, which is that the English invented Berlin. See, it sounds like the kind of thing he would say. But the reason I say it, and the reason I say it's true, is because in the 20th century, there are two English writers who more or less invent what Berlin is all about. One is Christopher Isherwood with Goodbye to Berlin, and his books are well read, and then they get made into a marvelous film with Joel Grey and Liza Minnelli called Cabaret. And this represents, if you like, a solid impression that people have of Berlin after the war, the Weimar period, the Nazi period, so I think it's a fair thing to say. Without Isherwood, what impression would we have had of Berlin? I don't know. Then, of course, after the war, there's another Englishman who comes along in the shape, probably more than one, actually, but if you count Len Dayton. But John le Carré. John le Carré's novel, The Spy Who Came In From the Cold, will undoubtedly be the great post-war novel, because this is the novel people will give to students, etc., and say, well, look, this is what it was like. 40 years of the Cold War summed up in one perfect novel with probably one of the most intricate little Swiss jeweled plots that you could imagine. It's a perfect plot. And so there you are, you've got one Englishman and another bookending the whole 20th century of Berlin. So I give you the English invented Berlin. Now, when I was first starting, I thought, well, can I fit somewhere in the middle? Can I be in that sandwich somewhere? And that was my ambition. And then about 3 or 4 years ago, I was in a bookshop in Berlin, and they had a little Berlin table. And there was a pile of Isherwood, and there was a pile of le Carré, and I was in the middle. And I got my iPhone out and sort of took loads of pictures and emailed them to everyone.
Yeah,
I'm there. Seriously, that is kind of, for me, that is kind of royalty to be in that kind of company. And I think it's what, you see, the point is that why the English are fascinated with Berlin. Well, it's easy to say why Isherwood was fascinated, but Auden and Spender, they went there because it was easy to be gay. After the First World War, the Weimar government didn't really care about that sort of thing. There were lots of refugees, there were people fed up with war, fed up with too much law, and there was a kind of license to do what you like. So Isherwood and Co. went there for cheap sex, really. Which seems as good a place, you know, good reason to go anywhere, really. The most important thing, though, is that people go to Berlin because they're all looking for a different Berlin, whether it's the Le Carré Berlin or the Isherwood Berlin, or Bowie goes there, David Bowie went there, Lou Reed went there. They're all looking for it, and it's a kind of state of mind, and it's a kind of liberal state of mind. It's almost like there's something free about this city, there's something louche about this city, something dark, there's something noir about this city. I personally feel it's a city that changes all the time. Every time I go, I always say I know Berlin really well enough to say that I hardly recognize it every time I go, because every time you go, a whole load of new buildings sprang up. I mean, the last time I went, the whole bit of Potsdamer Platz, there's this enormous kind of weird shopping mall that's like something out of Blade Runner. And it's astonishing. And Berlin is truly looks like the city of the future. There's something also I love about Berliners, which is this. They're fantastically rude and sharp and jagged. If you remember, again, Cabaret, the humour of Joel Grey, the MC, which is, I mean, it's so sharp you could cut yourself on it. But these are the kind of jokes I like. And these are the kind of jokes that Bernie Gunther likes. And I think, well, the genius, though, of the film Cabaret is it's written by someone who's Jewish, who has a deep, visceral understanding of the period and what it was like. And some of the songs are just fantastic. I mean, you have to hand it to someone who's Jewish, who can write a Nazi song. Because a lot of people are under the assumption that Tomorrow Belongs to Me is a real Nazi song, but it wasn't. It was written by him because they couldn't use any Nazi songs in the film, because if they did, they never got any distribution in Germany. So he thought, well, I'll write one. And he writes a fantastic one. And also, for my money, the high spot of bitter humor in the film is when Joel Grey sings to the gorilla the love song, "If You Could See Her Through My Eyes." And then the end of the song, "If you could see her through my eyes, she wouldn't look Jewish at all." And it's a fantastically bitter, hard, sharp joke about the period and the time and what the Germans were living through. So very long answer to your question there, sir. So, yes, sir.
What was your source material for guys like Nebbe and Schellenberg and Kaltenbrunner? Was there really as much animosity among them as you seem to portray?
They hated each other. That's the great thing about all these guys, is they feared and hated each other. And they were always doing things to each other that, you know, meant that they would be compromised and in somebody else's power. The source material is quite hard to find. I mean, in the case of Arthur Nebbe, very difficult. And he's probably one of the most difficult Nazis to write about anyway, because certainly in 1938 he's in the forefront of a plan for a putsch against Hitler. He's involved with lots of other people, the Osterplot, lots of other people who are trying to bring down Hitler. 3 years later he's in command of an Einsatzgruppen in Russia. And I think probably what happened is a lot of those people who were opposed to the Nazis, who were anti-Nazi and who thought Hitler was a madman, suddenly had a kind of thought, oh, well, maybe he is actually, you know, as good as he says he is, when he defeated France in 6 weeks in 1940. Nobody thought that was going to happen. Everybody thought the war was going to be a complete disaster, that they'd be back to trench warfare like the First World War. Nobody actually thought that it would be over in 6 weeks. And when when Hitler does this, the army are just so amazed that a lot of them actually sort of think, well, he can do no wrong. And I think Navy is one of them. But by then, by 1944, Navy's back in the fold of people who are, you know, probably part of the Stauffenberg plot. He was probably executed in the Stauffenberg plot afterwards. So he's one of the more interesting ones, but he's also quite difficult to find very much out about. There's not been anything written about him specifically. So he's a frequent character in my books because I find it's the conflict in the character that I find interesting. Just as the conflict in Bernie Gunther is an interesting one. He's someone who's trying to do the right thing, but equally he's trying to stay alive. And sometimes those two, you know, step on each other's toes. But always, whenever I'm writing about one, whether it's in a previous book, I wrote a lot about Goebbels, who's one of the more fascinating Nazis, I think. But what you've always got to remember is you've got to encounter them as people. You can't treat them as obvious cartoon monsters from the outset, because then the books just don't work. You've got to find the reason why they are where they are. And in Goebbels' case, you have to remember he got a PhD from Heidelberg. He's smart. He wrote a novel, which is another reason why I find him interesting as a novelist myself. I mean, it's jolly handy if you've not been published that you suddenly become the most powerful man in German publishing in 1933. So his novel, Michael, gets published immediately. But you have to remember, you see, you have to read stuff about what other people have said about these characters. And I mean, you have to remember that they were charismatic. I mean, Hitler was a deeply charismatic speaker. And it's no accident he was elected. He seduced the German people. German people aren't stupid. I love the Germans. Whenever I go, I sort of think, I cannot believe that it happened. They are smart, hardworking, they speak good English, they're polite, they're courteous. Christ, they speak better English than us. I mean, I have literally had conversations with Germans and said, hey, where are you from in England? And they say, I'm not from England, I'm from Germany. And you think, my God, their English is so good. They love England, you know, they're... So you have to sort of almost say it was a kind of moment of madness. It was a kind of a demoniac possession when the country got taken over by this man. Again, a very long answer to a short question. Yes, ma'am.
Have you been approached or thought about a movie or television?
Well, yes. I first wrote the books 30 years ago. And I got approached then, and I had a relationship with a German producer, and we talked about casting. That's always the thing, you know. So my original idea was there was a guy called Klaus Maria Brandau, who was a terrific German actor, who was in a wonderful film called Mephisto. He was in Out of Africa as the Baron. He had what I thought was right for a character like this, which is sort of twinkle in his eye, a bit of malice, a joke, authentically German looking, and quite good looking. A lot of women sort of seem to like him as well. Then gradually, it was quite obvious that, you know, that wasn't going to happen. Another early candidate for Bernie Gunther, wait for it, was Arnold Schwarzenegger. Well, that's what I said. And much as I, you know, love him in Conan the Barbarian, I really couldn't see him as Bernie Gunther. Well, now this series has been picked up by Sky Germany and HBO. So HBO are now going to sort of be making. I'm hoping that it. Well, the exec producer is Tom Hanks, and. He seems committed to sort of turning each book into a series. So I'm hoping we'll get a kind of Game of Thrones. or Game of Reich Chancelleries or something like that, maybe, you know. So that would be nice, actually.
Can I just go?
No, all of them. Mm. They bought all of them. So maybe that will happen. But Tom is a great enthusiast for the Second World War. And he's done several television series about it, and he came to the house, talked about it, did all his voices for the kids, which they loved. You know, he said, "Which of my movies do you like?" to the kids, and my daughter said right away, "Can you do Woody?" And, so he did Woody. And right, you know, and how can you not love somebody who will do also Forrest Gump for you for your kids as well? So I realized something quite interesting about Tom Hanks, which is that when I opened the door and he stood in front of me, we looked at each other, and I'm exactly the same height as Tom Hanks, and we're exactly the same age. We're about 2 weeks in difference. And he looked at me and said, "God, you look like my brother." And he's a great guy. And so hopefully with him behind it, then we might finally. But you know what? I mean, you know, I've sold lots of stuff to studios over the years, worked with lots of movie stars, which has been fun. But, you know, at the end of the day, the books are still there, and, you know, who knows. How are we doing for time? Maybe a couple more questions? Anybody else?
Yes, sir.
There was an op-ed piece this past Sunday in the Boston Globe commenting on the fact that the atrocities of the Germans in the post-World War and during World War II have been well documented, but the Russians, by way of contrast, particularly Stalin, have been given a free pass. Would you agree or disagree?
Totally agree. I mean, the Germans documented everything. That's the main difference. They took photographs. They, of course, they all had cameras. You know that. You know they when they went off to massacre people, they all took sort of Leicas with them and took photographs. And equally, there was all the legal justification for it, and the documentation was enormous. And all this was, you know, captured by the Allies. Now, nothing has ever been captured by the Allies because no one's actually invaded Russia, apart from the Germans, of course. But Stalin was very careful not to document stuff and to erase traces of stuff. I mean, like Katyn was, all you know, references to Katyn were erased. People who had actually been part of the Katyn Forest Massacre, you know, they were disappeared. So, and let's not forget, I'll get myself into trouble again here. The man who's now in charge is a former KGB officer. He was KGB chief in Dresden. So I think, you know, there was a brief moment when the Soviet Union opened up, you know, after Yeltsin, or with Yeltsin, it suddenly became possible that we could see democratic change. And indeed, Yeltsin himself was keen to talk about these things. It was Yeltsin who finally admitted the Russian, you know, the Russians had done Katyn, had killed all the Polish officers. Until then, nobody had said it. Well, we're back to a situation now when Putin more or less denies that it ever happened. And, you know, he, as far as he's concerned, if he was here now, he'd probably say it was the Poles. It was the Germans. So, for my money, I think Stalin was worse. I mean, the difference between Hitler and Stalin was you could disagree with Hitler. You could say, well, I don't think you're right, Mein Führer, about, you know, invading Russia this winter, you know. And he would argue with you, etc. And, you know, finally you'd come around to his way of thinking. But you didn't disappear. Whereas with Stalin, you disappeared. If you disagreed with Stalin, you were not around for very much longer. So I tend to sort of think that Stalin was worse, but that's just me. I hate the communists and I hate the lefties, and you know. I also, that's been one of the most amusing things about watching Mr. Trump, because I've got a theory. See, I think Mr. Trump is actually having a jolly good time upsetting a lot of liberal lefty folk. Yeah, he knows he's not going to be president, but I mean, if you've got all that money, you know, there's not a lot of things you can do to get your kicks. So just pissing people off must be enormous fun, actually. You know, I mean, if I had to spend $1 billion, I mean, I'd go for it. Just in Britain, you know, just to be able to sort of, you know, say, you know, whatever you like and upset people. It must be hilarious. I know, you might actually have to have this guy. a last question, and then I'll leave you. Anyone? Well, in that case, thank you very much. Yes, sir.
Some of your earlier books, or mid-books, you're in Eastern Europe countries, mm-hmm. Bernese, all of. Do you rely on literature for research? Or
no. I mean, do I have other people do my work? No, I hate all that. I think there's a thing, I don't know if the word is in America or not, but the serendipity factor, the accidental factor of work, because when you're doing your research, you look for stuff that you find almost by accident, and if you pay people who are professionals to go and do it, they will only go and look for the thing that you've told them to go and do. It's like a dog, you know, you get them, throw a ball and they'll bring the ball back. When I do my research, I want to not only find the ball, but I want to find a lot of other stuff as well. So I couldn't possibly have someone do that for me. And I enjoy it as well. I enjoy this.
Travel as well?
Yeah, I enjoy the tramping around and, you know, even going to Kaliningrad and all that kind of stuff. And you see, I think of myself as a kind of like an impressionist. I'm not looking to achieve a kind of photographic reality in what I write, because that could never happen. All I'm looking for is to sort of, if you like, when I go somewhere, to be able to make a sketch, and then I make a little sketch and I look for tiny little spots of detail, and I sort of think of myself more as a kind of impressionist painter, like sort of Georges Seurat, and I put little spots of colour, little details, and up close they don't mean very much, but when you take 10 or 15 steps back, then you have a kind of picture that sort of shimmers and creates a moment in time, and it's an impression, and nobody looks at Sierra and thinks it's real, but at the same time, if you screw your eyes up and look at it, it just gives you a feel of maybe what it was like to be there in a way that, you know, photograph can't do, and that's really all I'm ever trying to do. And so it's those little spots of, you know, that I'm looking for. It's like being a gold miner in the Klondike. You know, you're panning for gold, and you just pick out a tiny little spot from a pan and you put it in a little sack and you take it back to London and you know it will go back in the book. So you can't do that if you've paid somebody else to do that for you. Thank you very much.